Welcome, brand new episode of Backpass World Cup Countdown Special. So in case you've missed it, we've already covered two World Cups, Italia 90 and USA 94 last week. And in case you probably not heard of this before, this is the first time you're hearing about this show. What we're going to do is we are counting down the World Cups up to the last one, that which is 2018, just before the actual World Cup 2022 begins. So this is the whole concept of this Backpass World Cup Countdown show. And in the show, every week, we try and get a guest that was a native of the host nation or was there during the World Cup at that point of time, and a fan who was watching from this part of the world, Singapore, Malaysia, Southeast Asia. So in this week's show, it's my pleasure and an honor to have with me someone who is an ex-professional footballer. He's played in a number of countries, France, England, Holland, China, USA, and Singapore, of course. Middle East as well. Yes, I missed that out. Middle East. And he's also a former pundit. So without further ado, let me introduce Benoit Croissant. How are you doing, Benoit? Bonjour.
Bonjour. How are you doing?
Good, 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 good. Thanks for taking the time out to be on the show, man.
I appreciate that. Thanks for the invitation.
Welcome, welcome. And okay, Benoit, to start things off, France 98. Okay, France, you know, went through a golden period, right, in the 80s. You reached the semifinals of the 1982 and 86 World Cups. Arguably, probably the French would say unlucky to not reach the finals in both those World Cups. And you won Euro 84 as well. But then after that, Euro 88, you failed to qualify. Italia 90, you failed to qualify. And dramatically, USA 94, you failed to qualify. Euro 92, you were one of the favorites to actually win the tournament, but exited at the group stage. So at that point of time, you know, this when all this was going on, how was the reaction of the French public towards the French national team?
So yeah, so it was a very bad period, I guess, for France. You know, so the history of the French national team is pretty simple. So before the Second World War, France participated to all the World Cup, all of them, and apart the one in 1930, they just had to register, you know, to participate in this World Cup.
Yeah.
And most of the, although France was not one of the best, I would say, nation in Europe, it was very costly for a European side to travel to South America. But because Jules Rimet was part of the World Cup fundators, you know, so he was really pushing to get France to South America. All the players were not professional, so they traveled there and they participated to that World Cup. So we, you know, people forget, you know, but all the qualifying campaigns for France often turned sour, you know, missing, you know, the 1950 World Cup, the 1962 one, the 1970 and the 1974. And I don't even mention 1990 and 1994. So basically for France participating, you know, in all World Cups since 1998 is pretty surprising, you know, for the French people.
Okay.
So, you know, as you mentioned in 82, you know, I think it was a great generation with Platini, Giroud, Sigana, and all those guys playing that squad. And that they made a beautiful tournament in Mexico. And I think they would have deserved to go to the final and probably win, you know, that World Cup.
Yeah,
they also reached the semifinals in 1982. But, you know, it was less, I would say, phenomenal. You know, it was 1986 was really grandiose. And why, you know, I would say that they didn't manage to be performing well in the early 90s is pretty simple, because there was a huge transition from all those, you know, guys like Platini, Giroud, etc., like going out of the national team. Platini took over, you know, the national team, and this is where all the trouble started, you know, and there was a huge weakness in French football at that point of time, and people really didn't know that. You know, it was, we had some talented players, but the league itself wasn't good enough. So 90, 92 and 94 was a disaster. And you know, I would say that 94 of I was 14 years old at this, at that point of time, and I still remember Bulgaria scoring that goal in the last minute, and nobody, they let the player come from his own half, you know, box and go and score the goal, and nobody really tackle him or anything, you know. So that goal put us out of that, of that World Cup. So it was a real disaster. So, so yeah, that's a bit of history, you know, because sometimes people will think that, you know, France qualified to all the World Cup, but that is not that is not true.
Thanks for sharing that history with our listeners. But then after failing to qualify for the World Cup in 1994, going into Euro 96, did pretty well, reached the quarterfinals of Euro 96. Now coming to the World Cup that you are about to host here at, in 1998, what was the French public's expectation of the French national team?
So that was a big expectation from everyone. I would say that France never won anything, you know, never won the World Cup, you know, so organizing the World Cup in France, we had 6 years to prepare everything. We had a great generation of players as well. But at the same time, French likes to criticize. So, and even in our own country, you know, between one another. So I would say that Aimé Jacquet, who was the head coach at that point of time, was heavily criticized by the French media. It was a really, really big thing, you know, in France. And in the team and the head coach were really suffering from that. And the fact that the first game was played in Marseille was also another thing, because the French team, when they get prepared, they stayed at Clairefontaine. But because of that game in Marseille, they had to prepare everything in the south of France, so they were not used to that. And for the past 4 years, all trainings and training games were done in Clairefontaine. Okay. So I would say that winning the game against South Africa in Marseille, it was very windy, very tough game. And we managed to, when we won that game, we knew that something would happen. But prior to that game, nobody was convinced that we could go that far.
Okay, all right. So that's very nice. You've aged into the France 98 already. So let me bring on our fan of the week. And he is one half of the PLot Malaysia. Last week at USA, for the USA 94 episode, I had his partner, Hari Krishan. But this week, we've got Ram, Ranai. How are you doing, Ram?
I'm doing good. Hi, bonjour, Benoit. Hi, nice to meet you.
How are you, mate?
Hi, Ras. Nice to meet you as well.
Yes, of course. Yes. Ram, you're in Singapore now, right?
Yes. I am finally in Singapore right now. So it looks like all three of us are in the same
place. All three of us here in Singapore now, yeah. Okay, Ram, just touching on your memories. Don't go into the games or players and all that. Going into France 98, how old were you at that point of time?
I was an amazing 15-year-old boy. You know, it was secondary school. Thank God for the school holidays. I could watch the game and stay up late. So, yeah, you know, that was me at during the France 98 World Cup. Yeah.
Okay. All right. So, I was a year younger than you. I was 14 years old at that point of time. And so, yeah, same as you, school holidays and all. I'm not sure if you remember, but there used to be a game, the FIFA Road to World Cup game. I'm not sure if you played that game. So that was one of the games that I used to play during the holidays. Yeah.
Yes.
So you had the Blur song.
yes.
And one, I Get Knocked Down. That's the other song that used to be in that game, right?
Absolutely. Yeah. So that was fantastic.
Those were my memories. Yeah. And I remember when the World Cup started, I went gung ho because I was a bit older. This is my second World Cup I'm watching. So I was a bit older, it was school holidays. I thought, okay, let's go and watch all the matches. Eventually made me sick. I got a fever, so I had to scale down a bit. Scale down on my enthusiasm. So yeah, those were my early memories. Benoit, yourself, how old were you when this World Cup started?
I was 17 years old.
17 years old. Okay. Yeah. Do you manage to catch any of the matches in the stadium?
So, yeah, that's a good question. I would have loved to go to the stadium and watch games, but the great news at that point of time is in June, I was communicated by the club while I was playing for Tour 3, playing in League One at that point of time. They told me that I would start training with a professional. So I had to train. I had to train during the World Cup, so we started training during that time. So I couldn't travel. I had to stay in town, but I do not regret it because it was such an amazing atmosphere. And you know, I mean, I was there with my friends, with my colleagues. You know, so that was just great.
Which was the nearest stadium for you at that point in time?
My point of time was Paris, probably Paris.
Paris, okay.
Yeah, Paris. Yeah.
All right, man. Well. You didn't watch any of the matches, but I'm sure you would have caught it on TV, right, Benoit?
Yeah. So it was a big thing. You know, I mean, every game, you know, I would say we would meet with friends and organize a dinner and, you know, like any World Cup we do now, you know. But the good thing is, you know, I had a friend with a big screen and we were like, I don't know, 40, 50 people watching the games. And I would say that, you know, every time we, you know, all the games were crazy, you know, for the French team, you know, we can speak about that later, you know, but I mean,
yeah,
it was so much tension and so much happiness, you know, after every final whistle, you know, going into the street and celebrating, it was something very particular, you know, especially in France where, you know, you had a kind of social and, economic crisis at that point of time, so it was like a good thing also to bring everybody together.
Okay, guys, talking about France 98, any teams that surprised you besides probably the obvious would be Croatia, but in some cases maybe Croatia wasn't much of a surprise as well. Maybe start with you, Benoit.
I would say I'm a French guy, you know, so at the end, you know, I would speak about, you know, probably the teams we played against. So I was, you know, very surprised by the quality of the Paraguayan team. Paraguay.
Yes, Paraguay, yeah.
I would say that France managed to qualify without problem for the round of 16, you know, with three victories. And we faced Paraguay I think it's end of June, 28 to 29th of June in Lens, you know, in the western part of France. And I still remember the goalkeeper, Chilavert. They assured that Paraguay defense was impossible. So basically tomorrow nothing will get into the net. And basically it happened.
That's what happened, because,
you know, Laurent Blanc's golden goal in the 114th minute, you know, was, you know, like a relief for everybody because we thought we will never score that goal, you know. So I would say I was really surprised by that team. And honestly, that would have been a huge shock for everybody if we had been, you know, disqualified by Paraguay. But they were pretty good for me, yeah.
Yeah, I think you were so close to the match going to the penalty shootout that in that game. And if you had gone to the penalty shootout, do you think France might have won it? Would you have been confident against Chilavert?
Difficult. That's what I'm saying. The guy was a wall, you know. So, I mean, lucky we scored that goal. And it was, you know, the golden goal. When you score, the game is over, you know. So that was, you know, so score, the game is over. You know, this was great. But, it would have been difficult during penalty shots.
Okay, I think Paraguay, good shout. Agreed, one of the surprise teams of the tournament. I think every one of us knew about Chilavert going into this tournament, so we were all probably excited to see how he does, and he did well. Ram, yourself, any surprise teams?
For me, because it was the first real World Cup, I really sat and watched all the games, you know.
Okay.
So for me, I think the one team that really stood out for me was also Norway. Because for me, you know, when you're in the same group as Brazil, you know, we got Morocco, Scotland, you know, I was expecting Norway to probably be in the third of the group. But, you know, to come and also to beat Brazil in the group stages, that shocked me. you know, and finishing second in the grade in the group, and of course not losing a game in the group stages, that was quite surprising for me, because I thought they were more defensive, but they really, really took the game to the teams they were playing, and I thought they could have gone further in the competition. But I would definitely give a shout out to this team, because this was a Norway team that was like at the golden era, you know, where they were at their prime. That you may not see the same Norway team right now today, but those are the players that really stood out, like Tore André Flo, you know, of course, you know, Ole Gunnar Solskjaer, and all these players that were actually playing, but they were fantastic, absolutely. I have to give a shout out to them.
That result, I think the one beating Brazil, that was the first surprise of the tournament. In that same group, I think Morocco did quite well. They had quite a good tournament. So they were favorites to go through, because Brazil was playing Norway. Everyone thought Brazil was going to beat Norway, and then Morocco was going to play. Morocco were playing Scotland, and they were winning quite easy that one. And, you know, and it all turned in like probably the last few minutes of that game, in the dying stages of that game, you know. So that was quite an exciting moment of that World Cup. Good shout out. I would also like to shout out Denmark. I think Denmark did quite well. Yeah, Denmark did quite well. Went to, I remember when they played Nigeria in the second round, everyone thought Nigeria is going to win, you know, because this was the golden generation of Nigeria. And they thought, you know, Nigeria is going to beat Denmark, but Denmark, you know, completely beat them 4-1, and then got into the quarterfinals, played Brazil, didn't lose by much, 3-2, very narrow defeat. So I think Denmark's another shout out for surprise of the tournament. But let me just ask the two of you, Croatia going into this World Cup, surprise or no, Benoit?
Croatia, I mean, they always surprise every World Cup. It's such a small nation. They've got some amazing players, and if I'm not wrong, I think Suker, you know, during the World Cup was the super, best goal scorer. If my memory is good. And they, not only Suker, in each line they had amazing players. I remember Boban was to me, you know, at that point of time, was the best midfielder, you know, in the world. Of course, with Zidane, etc. But, you know, they had a great team. Yeah. Again, each line you had like a star player playing in Italy or playing somewhere else. So, and they prove it, that is a great football nation. Again, you know, playing the final against France in against another thing, but in 2018, you know, they are just talented players there in this country.
Yeah, certainly. I wasn't too surprised. Maybe the surprise would be that they reached the semi-finals, but I knew the talent they had in their squad. Ram, for yourself, first time hearing of Croatia and their players in this World Cup?
Yeah, I mean, to be honest, you know, Croatia definitely surprised me, because I didn't know who the hell Suke was, to be honest, at that point of time. I didn't know Boban, you know, all these names were very alien to me. But watching the way they played and the way they scored the goals and the way Suke scored the goals, you know, during that entire tournament, and of course, being the golden boot, he put Croatia on a map, you know, during that World Cup. And I think, you know, it's a perfect testament, because when you watch players like this during the 98 World Cup in Croatia, for Croatia national team, they were a testament to how Croatia is right now. If you watch how the Croatian team is currently playing, like what, you know, Benoit said about the last World Cup, them reaching the finals against France, I think this Croatian side, small nation, they have maximum talent. And I think it's just going to keep growing from there. And I think it wouldn't surprise me that eventually, you know, during our lifetime, hopefully, you know, they actually will carry the World Cup at some point.
Yeah, you know, probably, so. Yes.
Yeah.
They keep churning out this one generation after another, right, of talented players.
Yep, definitely.
Yep. Another player I'm going to shout out. Pardon?
To add on what Ram said, you know, I think Croatia is one of the most scouted country in Europe when it comes to young players. So it's just unbelievable the number of kids they generate, you know, they developed in this country.
Okay, another player I'm going to shout out from that Croatian team was Robert Prosinecki. I think that was another good player in midfield as well. And defense, you got Stimak, Bilic, Jani, Yeah, so those were the players. Vlahovic up front with alongside Suker. I think that was like an underrated player because of Suker getting all the limelight. I think Vlahovic, his strike partner, was a bit underrated. Okay, moving on to teams that disappointed you. Ram, any team that you were expecting big time, something big from them, and then they disappointed you?
Well, I've always been an England fan, but I'm not going to say so much about England in this World Cup. They did reach the quarterfinals, but I think
you'll speak about England soon.
Yeah, but Spain is one team that I was hugely disappointed, you know, in that World Cup. I did not expect them to go out so early, and you know, knowing the group that they had, you know, I was surprised that they lost most of their games, and you know, they didn't make it through the group stages. So for me, yes, that was a huge disappointment, because if you look at Spain, not only the team, the national team, but if you look at their league, the La Liga, for example, they've got so much talent. Sometimes I feel, you know, this national team, they don't really, during the 98 World Cup, I think the top players were not really picked to be in that squad, you know, but, and yeah, unfortunately for them, but that is the huge disappointment for me, I feel, Spain. Mm.
Okay. Benoit, yourself?
Me? So it will be very surprising for you. I don't think you will expect this one. I will say Brazil. It's probably some people will say, why is he saying Brazil? You know, they reached the final. I think Ronaldo was voted the best player of the tournament, etc. The thing I didn't like about it's all the controversies, you know, that went on, you know, after the World Cup, and still now we're still talking about that, claiming that, you know, there were some money bribing or that kind of things. I think people don't understand that winning the World Cup for a football player is the biggest achievement, you know, that you can reach. I don't see anyone, you know, me as a football player, you come to me and say, I give you $15 million, you know, to not play the game and lose it, you know, I will not take it, because the only thing I want is to win that cup. So all the things around, you know, that final, Ronaldo being sick, or, you know, Nike, you know, you had a lot of things.
Yeah, around Nike, I remember that one.
That disappointed me a lot, because Brazil never really, as a nation, they never really went against it. You know, they play the game, you know, like, Ronaldo was sick.
They were the victims.
Yeah, the victims. Yeah. So it's like Ronaldo was sick. We never seen any picture of that, you know. One hour before, prior to the game, you know, he was not on the players list, starting 11. Then suddenly, 10 minutes before, you know, the guy is on it. You know, so it's like, again, it's try to destabilizing the guys, you know, the French, you know, at that point. After, it would have been another country, I would think exactly the same. So, if you ask me about disappointment, I would say that, you know, like, take a strong point, you know, and just say, no, we had nothing to do with that. We play our football game because we wanted to win the World Cup. We're not good enough. And that's all, you know, and keeping silent. And, you know, so that's my biggest disappointment about this nation.
Okay. All right. We'll speak more about the final later. But that was a surprise. Yeah, Benoit, I didn't expect that at all. But for me, Spain was a big disappointment, and Nigeria would be another one that I was disappointed with, because they started off the group stage really well. That exciting win against Spain, 3-2, and they had won the gold medal in the Olympic Games as well. Then suddenly just collapsing against Denmark in the second round, you know. So that for me was a big disappointment, Nigeria. So Ram, you've already spoken that you're an England fan.
Yeah.
As you can see, I'm an Italy fan. So Benoit, this is a question for you as a native. You know, you've been in Asia for quite some time now. What's your, you know, reaction to Asians supporting a European country or South American country at World Cups and supporting it with passion? What's your reaction to that?
That's a good question. I think we spoke about that before. Right, so we spoke about that in the past. I would say that if you live in a country where it's 99% sure that your country will never reach even the Asian Football Confederation Cup. You know that they will never play the World Cup. So you need to support, if you're a football fan, you will support another country. But it's very, I would say, this is very Asian. This is very Asian. We know that football is in Europe. You know, I mean, we know that, you know, this is where the best football is played, obviously, you know, nobody can deny that. And I can also understand that Asian will support a particular club. But this is something that we, you know, as, you know, Europeans, we don't. It's like, you will support a club that is, you know, your, like, kind of provincial, you know, town, if you don't live
where you come from,
where you're from. And if you get some origins from another country, if you're Italian, if you have your grandparents are from Spain, they will support like Real Madrid, and they will kind of have like a favorite team, like they will call it like something like that. But for us, it's something very strange. It's something we don't really talk to one another. And I've been living here for 14 years, and I'm always very surprised when I hear, people say, I support Liverpool, I support Manchester United. And there is nothing bad against it. It's just, for me, it's a bit strange. And all my friends know that, I think. But I don't really have a point of view about that. It's just like a feeling. And I know some people will dislike what I say now. But you know me, Raz, you know, I just say what I think, you know. But again, this, at the same time, I understand. I understand that you will support a bigger team. You will support some, you know, a team that win trophies, that bring fans together. I can understand that.
Okay. So thanks for putting that point out, because I know your point of view on that. I just want the listeners to know as well. Okay. In this World Cup, actually, we didn't have as many surprise teams, but we had a lot of big showdowns. So all your big nations playing against each other in the knockout stages. So one knocking the other one out. We'll start with the first one, Argentina versus England. What a game that was. Okay, England fan Ram, please bring us away with this game.
My goodness. I mean, watching that game was of course surprising, you know, the match ending, of course, thinking it would go down, you know, 2-2, you know, and of course, going down to penalties and so on. But the moment it reached penalties, right, Ras, I was like, I think we're going to lose this game. It was in my mind, I was thinking, I said, there's no way that England is going to be, going to come up front against Argentina. But to be very honest with you, I was happy to know that, okay, we could still score goals. Michael Owen scored a beautiful goal in that game. And of course, a huge disappointment was, of course, one of my favorite players, David Beckham, you know, getting sent off for the most ridiculous of reasons, against Simeone. I didn't know why he had to do that. That took away a lot of sting that England could actually do in that game. Because I don't know if you guys agree with me, I think if England had the full 11 players in the team, I think they could still pose a threat, in that game and possibly take the game further. But because of Beckham's red card, I felt it was just sad. But credit to Argentina, because they stuck to the game plan, you know, they did what they had to do, and they went all out and they gave a good fight. So yeah. Mm.
Yeah. Benoit, do you watch this match?
Yeah, I obviously watched it. I think for me, the highlight is Owen's goal. You know, that was a fantastic goal from the line, you know, bringing the ball, nice control, going forward. And this is basically, for those who are not watching English football, you know, it was like a revelation. See who this guy is from, you know, it was just crazy. And of course, Beckham, as you said, you know, being sent off, I think he was only the second English player to be sent off in the World Cup, I think. And as you, it was just a fantastic game with some nice goals. England, they probably had the best generation they never had. So maybe I'm wrong, but this is what I think, you know, in that year. And that was a real pity that they went away. And it's stupid to say that, but Beckham really didn't really deserve that. You know, it was just a reaction. We had the same with Zidane. You know, what happened when he headbutt Maserati, you know, so we had the same kind of situation, but we were in the final. That's a different thing, a few minutes. But yeah, it was such a tense game. Yeah, it was.
Yeah. Another goal I want to pinpoint on, I think deserve some spotlight, would be Javier Zanetti's goal. I think that was a great set piece move by Argentina for that goal, and he placed it well.
Zanetti. Yeah. When Zanetti scored, I remember this goal with his left foot. Yeah.
And the other thing I got to say, I watched this match again. I mean, I didn't watch it in 98 at all. I only know what happened through the newspapers and all, but I watched it in full about maybe sometime this year. And one fun fact, Ram, the linesman is Malaysian. The linesman is Malaysian. Yes, true. It's true. Unfortunately, he has passed on. So that is unfortunate, because I was actually thinking, oh man, the linesman is Malaysian. Maybe if I could get hold of him for an interview, it would be fun.
Well, that would be fantastic. Yeah,
that would be fun. But then unfortunately, I found out he's passed on. And anyways, going back to that game, I felt England could have won it, because before Zanetti scored, England had a huge chance to make it 3-1. They missed it.
Yep.
And then there was that Sol Campbell goal that was disallowed, which should have stood, I think. I didn't see much of a foul in that instance. So I felt England a bit hard done by.
If only they had VAR then, right?
Yeah, correct. You never know, right? Yeah. But yeah, it is what it is. So England were out. So Argentina won that game. They went on to play another big team, Holland. Argentina-Holland in the quarterfinals. That was another great game. That game I watched.
What a game.
Yeah,
my favorite game of the quarterfinals. Yeah.
All right. Okay, Benoit, you watched that match, Holland against Argentina?
I watch all the games. It's not like in Asia, you need to wake up at 2 or 3 a.m. in the morning. So I watch all of them.
Thankfully for that, for us, that Holland Argentina game was I think about 10. So it's quite friendly timing. It was quite friendly timing for us. So that's why we managed to watch that. But talk to us about that match, Benoit.
So, yeah. So, again, I mean, when you reach, that level of football, I would say Argentina against Holland, you know, when you have so many stars in one playing against each other, you know, it was just incredible. We were speaking about teams, you know, that were playing good football. You know, I think Holland were playing good. You know, Holland were playing good football. I think Frank de Boer, you know, was just fantastic on the back. You had Bergkamp. We cannot fly, but he was lucky to take the train and go to France and play the World Cup. So, again, very tense game. We had Batistuta, you know, on fire. I think he scored 5 goals during the World Cup, you know. And the two things, again, the two highlights I would get from this game is, the first thing is, Argentina, you know, like holding the game, doing okay, and you have Ortega like giving headbutting Van der Sar.
Van der Sar.
And I remember because I was like, why Van der Sar is, you know, like doing everything with excess going on the ground, and because I was still young, a young footballer, you know, so I couldn't understand, you know, that kind of thing. So I was a bit mad at Van der Sar, but when you understand the repercussion, you know, afterwards you understand why he's doing it. And I would say Beckham scoring that goal 2 minutes after, or 2 or 3 minutes after.
Oh, that was a great goal.
One of the best goals, you know, of the World Cup. And you can see like that I would say, combination of skills, of coordination, of understanding, awareness of the goal and where the ball comes, you know. So, I mean, that was just magnificent, you know. And yeah, so it's funny because now it's 24 years ago and you still have like some memories of certain games. And these are really the two things that I will pick from the game. Yeah.
Yeah. Do you feel the sending off for Ortega was soft?
I think it was a bit soft. But Ortega through the whole game was shouting, talking to the referee. And forget that Argentinians were during a game, they keep insulting, they keep, you know, they speak very loud, So, I mean, at the end of the day, if you do one mistake, when this game it was so tough, lose a lot of pressure, the referee also has got this pressure. And at the end, you do one mistake, boom, it's down, you know. So, it is done, this mistake. any played so well. I don't think played so well during that World Cup. So that's
he did. Correct. Through Ram yourself, your memory of this match.
Wow, this game is what is my favorite game of a tournament, to be honest. You know,
It's your favorite game. Who scored first?
Of course, Patrick Kluivert scored first on a 12th minute. Yeah, I still remember.
Nice.
The lead didn't last long, you know. Of course, then Lopez scored the equalizer, and then
Claudio Lopez was all left foot in that one. You know, I remember his one on one with Vendesa. He was never gonna shoot that with his right.
Yeah.
By all means, he was always positioning it on his left, and then he scored.
But the one thing about this game, Ras, and of course, Bruno, I want to tell you this. You know, this is the game that both teams had everything in equivalent. Okay, you talk about, you know, Ortega getting sent off. Paul, even Newman got sent off. You know, so both teams had a red card in this game, and it was just at that final, you know, that literally the final moments of the game. Bergkamp was the one that separates, and what a goal! I agree with you totally, Benoit. That goal was out of this world. Like, you know, how he took it down and how he actually, you know, used the side of his foot, you know, to wave past the goalkeeper. I thought that was just brilliant. It was art. It was pure artistic, you know, the way the finish was. Brilliant game.
Okay. So, Holland progressed to the semi-final. Who they face next? Brazil. Ram, at this point of time, Holland, Brazil, schools were reopened. We got to go back to school. We got to go back to school. This match was early in the morning. Do you catch this match?
I remember because during this time in school, I was in secondary three. I remember very well, you know. And of course, because England got knocked out of the World Cup, so I was supporting Brazil all of a sudden, you know. hopefully, they could win the World Cup. And I had a friend who was a Holland supporter as well. And he kept taunting me. He's like, he kept laughing at me, making fun of me. He's like, Holland is going to win. And then the news came out that, of course, Brazil, you know, drew 1-1. And of course, they went to win on penalties. I could not watch that game, guys, to be honest, because it was too late. I was on a curfew because of my age.
I understand.
And when I went to school the next day, I was looking for the new paper. Remember, Ras, So I was waiting for the new paper to show the scoreline. I was like, oh, Brazil won, and finally, I know at that point of time. But it was a good moment for me because I could just, you know, have a go at my friend, you know, and tease him a little bit. So yeah, it was fun, enjoyable, definitely for sure.
Okay, so Benoit, you watched that match. This one, very even game, 1-1, went all the way to extra time, settled by penalty shootout. Your memories of this match, Benoit?
So the thing I remember very clearly is Holland play so well against Argentina. And the funny stuff, when they play against Brazil, they were not calm. They were anxious. They were not playing their football. You could not really recognize the players. Kluivert, I think, missed, I don't know how many chances he missed during that game. And of course, he finally managed to score that goal, you know, at the end, you know, at the end of the game, but he missed so many opportunities, you know. And again, you know, is Brazil has the experience, you know, to reach a final, you know, and you could feel that sense of inferiority where, you know, you had a team without any history of winning World Cup, you know, winning big competitions, and you had one team with more confidence, with a great striker, and with a great team, you know, and they made the difference in the penalty shoot, you know. And I always believe that you don't really gamble when you go to the penalties, you know. The team with confidence will always win, you know, and the most anxious will lose. And that's exactly what happened in that game to me. It's really like Holland was scared to play against Brazil, and they did not play their football. So that's what I think. And again, they had the chance, they equalized so far at the 88 or 89 minutes, I don't remember, at the end of the game. But it wasn't enough. And I think Ronald de Boer missed that penalty, you know, at the end.
They lost 4-2 on penalty in the penalty shootout.
So yeah, that's very obvious. Yeah.
So Taffarel once again proving triumphant on the penalty shootout. Okay, then last one we're going to speak about, Benoit, this will be close to you. France versus Italy in the quarterfinals. Going into this match, there were a number of French players that were playing in Serie A. So the Italian players knew about the French players, and vice versa, the French players knew about the Italian players as well. And it turned out to be a very even, cagey game, nil-nil draw in the end, settled by the penalty shootout. Benoit, going into this match, do you feel maybe, or did the French probably felt that, okay, Italy maybe could be tricky for the French to overcome?
Not at that point of time. The reason is because I think France, in 1998, France did not lose against Italy since 1978. So at the end of the day, the pressure was not on France at that point of time. So France was playing at home against a side that didn't win against, you know, like the past 20 years, you know. So there was that confidence on the French side that was obvious. The fact that they won against Paraguay and Croatia in such a weird manner, you know, but that gives so much confidence to that team. They were much stronger. But again, playing against Italian is never easy, you know, and that is also the reason why French love suspense. So they had to go to the penalty shootout, you know. So I mean, again, playing in Stade de France was good. This is probably where, you know, that stadium was also very important for the French squad. They were used to that stadium. They were used to winning the stadium. So again, you go to the penalty shootout, then you know that you're going to win it. And they believed on that dream, and they knew that anything could happen, and everything was on their side, you know, at that point of time. So that's also, you need a bit that confidence, you know, during those big events.
Okay, right. That game decided by one miss. That was by Di Biagio hitting the bar. All right, now going to standout players in this tournament. I think there were a lot of players, right, that stood out. Ram, you want to take a pop at some of them?
Yeah, I have four players that I've actually, put on my list. I want to start off with Davor Suker, of course, because like I said earlier, you know, I wasn't really very aware of him then, back in 98. I thought, you know, having the golden boot, that was something that I never expected, and he did a good job. So hats off to him, you know, what he achieved. Dennis Bergkamp, of course, has to get a mention, because every time he plays a game for club and country, he always tends to do his best. And I think, even though he doesn't like flying, you know, he still does what he can, you know, on the field. That's great. One of my favorite players, aside from that, is JJ Okocha. I've always enjoyed watching this guy play. I mean, regardless of how disappointing Nigeria was in the tournament, but I thought this guy really played with his heart and soul. The famous skills that he had was so evident. Every time he pulls out that skill, you know, he always gets past a player. He's always creating chances. And he's one of those players that, you know, I wish was still playing today, you know, to be honest. Because it's so exciting. He's so exciting. And of course, my last and final, last but not the least, I have to give hats off to Zinedine Zidane. Because I knew who he was, but at the age of 15, I wasn't really like, you know, didn't get a chance to really watch a lot of those games, clubs that he was actually playing. But I knew he was a great player, and he's one of those players until today, I think, is the most toughest player to get the ball off. You know, he could be holding on to the ball so well, you can't get a tackle off him. He's just that good. So yeah, these are the four players that I think really stood out for me in the World Cup.
Okay, Benoit, yourself, anyone else other than what Ram has mentioned?
It's difficult. So Zidane, I'm French, I had to say Zidane.
Certainly.
I have to say it. You don't want me to say it, but I say it. So Zidane, I think I mentioned one before, is Frank de Boer. I think Frank de Boer was, I was defender, you know, so looking at this, I was defensive midfielder, defender, so it was such a pleasure to look at him, you know, he could play in any position, added himself to any tactical changes, you know, it was just amazing. I'd like Cafu as well. Cafu was very good during that World Cup. You know, always overlapping, crossing, giving play to all the opponents. You know, it was just fantastic. And I would say that Beckham for me, was a different player. You know, he's like a Zidane. You know, he's able to do things technically that we can't do. And those would be my really standout players.
Choices, okay. Yeah, Batistuta will be one more. I would name Batistuta, Michael Owen. Michael Owen came out in this tournament. Christian Vieri for Italy. The Laudrup brothers in Denmark, Brian and Michael Laudrup. I thought they had quite a good tournament as well. So just, I think there's so many. We've already mentioned Boba and Prosinecki and the Croatian players. From the French team, I think the entire backline, Thuram, Long, Desailly, Lizarazu, Barthez in goal, I think they played really well. So yeah, like I say, I think in this era, I felt in the 90s and all, we had so many choices. We were spoiled for choices. A lot of good players, a lot of standout players that we could name. Now going on to the final, Benoit, big moment. France, first ever World Cup final against Brazil. Interestingly enough, every time France has gone to the World Cup final, you have won it. You have got 100% record so far. Or rather, sorry, you lost in 2006.
Against Italy.
I remember that now.
Yeah, remember that now.
Yeah.
If you're an Italian friend, you know, you remember it clearly. But most of the finals won it. We didn't have any, to be honest. We play a lot of semi-finals as well. The thing about that final is, I would say that beyond the performance on the pitch, I will really say that, you know, the players, each player had his a really important place in the group, and them with different personalities, and they really managed to communicate, to speak together, to play together, to really make the difference, you know. And and I would say that the fact that the Brazilian probably they snapped the warm-up, you know, the 20 minutes, you know, after they found out that Ronaldo was playing, you know, they've done a lot of things that even they thought that will weaken the French squad, but to give them extra confidence and strength, I think. And when they came into that game, that's why they killed them, you know, to be honest. That's all those little things that happen in the past, you know, 24 hours prior to the game that really bring the players, you know, together and to win.
Okay, leading up to the final, I got some questions for you, Benoit. Zidane got sent off quite early in the tournament against Saudi Arabia for stamping on his opponent. So did it have a big impact? I mean, even we know the results, we know what happened, but do you feel that at that point, okay, he got sent off, we could struggle here? Do you feel it at that time?
You mean Zidane when he gets sent off against Saudi Arabia?
Yeah.
I mean, you know, we were a bit afraid of the consequences, you know, what will happen for him, how many games would he be, you know, out, you know, for the game, because it was a clear foul and stamp on the Saudi players, you know. But at the same time, we knew that Zidane was one of the best midfielders, you know, in the world with Boban, as I said before. So we knew that he would step up and make that difference. I would say that the most curious part was when Blanc get out for I think it was for the final. So that was a bit of a worry for us, because Blanc was obviously the leader, you know, very close combatants playing together, etc. So that was more of a worry for the French public than Zidane against Saudi Arabia.
Okay, and on that Blanc Barthez thing, I think we saw that superstition thing that Blanc and Barthez started kissing, Blanc kissing Barthez on his head before the game. I think that was certainly one of the moments of the World Cup that we remember, right?
Indeed,
yeah, definitely.
It was.
Another point, Benoit, on the French team, your strikers at that point of time, it said that you did not have actually a prolific striker, because you got Stefan Gyuach, you got Christophe Dugarry, not really your prolific strikers. Then you had Trezeguet and Thierry Henry were still very young and in that World Cup. It didn't affect France at all, right?
But it was a big question mark prior to the World Cup. But the funny part about that is Gyuach was our main striker, number 9. And in the season 1997-1998, he was the best goal scorer in France, playing for Auxerre, who was not, you know, Marseille or, you know, another top club. It was only Auxerre. He had, don't know how many goals he scored at that point of time. So we really believe that he will score that goal, which he didn't. So we really rely on Dugarry and Zidane and Thierry Henry, you know, and the young guys, as you said, you know. And Gyuach didn't score a single goal, you know, during that World Cup. He played the final as well. And it was really a team effort. You know,
that's team effort, true.
We say that squad was really different. Everybody could score, make a difference. Turan scoring a brace against Croatia. So they were able to really, it was really helping each other, you know, and going for it and getting the victory, you know. So that's why this squad, you know, managed to get it. And the last World Cup, when we won the World Cup in 2018, Giroud didn't score a goal during the World Cup. So it is not because your main striker or long striker is not scoring that you're not winning a World Cup. It's how you work together and what they bring to the team.
Yeah, true. Exactly. I completely agree with you on that. There's another French player, underrated, I would say, Youri Djorkaeff. I thought he had a good tournament. That was another attacking threat for the French to have. Ram, yourself, you are a converted Brazil fan by this time.
well, for me, were you shocked by the result? I was shocked because I remember that I wanted to watch the game. I couldn't watch the whole game. You know, I had to go and sleep because then again, as a kid. But I remember that I couldn't sleep the whole night. So this was my memory, you know, post World Cup final. In my head, I kept thinking Brazil was going to win. You know, I couldn't sleep the whole night. So when the time came for me to wake up for school, I got down, quickly turned on the TV. You know, last time, Raz, they had the teletext.
Teletext, yes.
Yeah.
I remember that. Yeah.
Teletext, you know, I wanted to get the immediate, you know, score. And I keyed in that. And I was like, what? What just happened? You know, what happened to Brazil? You know, France won 3-0. And of course, you know, I managed to watch the highlights and things like that. And I also realized that, of course, Desai got sent off during the final, right? He was sent off. But I think overall, when I watched the highlights, when I saw, I think earlier to what Benoit said was very evident, because Brazil did not show that fight that they had in the previous games. And I think France showed that, you know, that they really wanted to win this game so badly. I think it's also a testament because, you know, like what Ras, you said about, you know, France not qualifying for a few of those World Cups in the earlier years, in the 80s and early 90s. I think the fact that they actually reached the final for the first time in 98, I think they really, really, really wanted to prove a point. And I think they really went all out and they got the result. So kudos to France for winning that World Cup. I think that put them in that spot where now they are one of the top teams, you know, in world football. So yeah, very, very good goals by Zidane and, of course, Emmanuel Petit. Yeah.
Yeah, okay. I was supporting France in that final because Brazil and Italy, you know, head-to-head for the World Cup. Number of World Cup titles won. Brazil's got 4 and then Italy had 3 at that point of time. Yeah. So I didn't want them to age further forward. So France had none. So, you know, why not support the so-called underdogs here? And thankfully, France won. So yeah, that was my memory of that final, and I think Zidane certainly cemented himself as one of the best players in the world at that point in time, alongside a lot of others, but he was the standout player of that World Cup. Right. So just a quick check. We mentioned about Barthez, Blanc. Any other lasting memory from this World Cup? We mentioned maybe a goal celebration or some sending off, whatever, you know, any other memories you got?
I think Shilawat is the only goalkeeper until now that will ever take a free kick. And it was the first time I've ever seen a goalkeeper do that. you know, in that World Cup. So yeah, I think that was a very fond memory. The moment I think of Shilawat is, oh, this is the free kick goalkeeper in my mind.
For me, I will go with, I have to mention this because Roberto Baggio is my favorite player of all time. And to get that opportunity to score that penalty against Chile to draw that game, you can sense the pressure on him when he took the ball, when he got the penalty. He was lucky, I would admit to you, that the penalty was lucky to be awarded, but he got awarded and you could see the pressure was on him. He took the ball, put it on the spot. Some of his teammates were trying to tell him, never mind, let me take it. But he still took it. He took it, put it in the corner, and that was like a huge sigh of relief. So 4 years of torment was over. But of course, whatever happened in 94 stuck with that guy, but that 4 years of torment was over, and that was that. You know, it was also great that he made it in the World Cup squad at the last minute. So that was also another thing that was very delighted about to know for France 98. And one other thing I got to say about France 98, and this is on the Brazil team. Leading up to France 98, I don't know if you guys remember, but Brazil were frighteningly good with Romario and Ronaldo as a strike partnership. Yeah. And Romario was in the actual squad, but he had to pull out because of an injury. I remember the press conference, he was in tears. You know, shows how much it means to play for your country, for these players. You know, and probably this generation of players that we are talking about now, is in the 90s and all that, this it means a lot for them to play for their country, play for in at the World Cups and all. It showed, you know, it showed when, you know, how Maradona came back from a long period out of the national team to play at 94 World Cup, and then unfortunately he got hauled up for failing a drug test. And then I've already mentioned the story about Baggio making back into the Italy squad right at the date. So a lot of such examples of players that did all they could to play for their country. Yeah. Benoit, yourself, you got anything that...
Zidane, yeah? Zidane left the French team, he came back to play the 2006 World Cup.
Yeah.
He was out
That's 2006. Another good example, right?
Yeah.
Alongside Thuram and Makalele as well.
Yeah.
Yep. All right, guys. It's been nice chatting. A lot of memories. The final part, let's get to our France 98 11. What do you got, Benoit?
So to me, you know, you can imagine that there would be a few French players in that squad.
Of course, of course, of course. I'll be surprised if we had none.
I will put Barthez, you know, as a goalkeeper, but I will think that Chilavert also deserves to be there, you know. So I will put the two of them, you know, together. Desailly, Frank de Boer, so which I mentioned before. Mm. I hesitated between Thuram and Cafu on the right side, probably. Mm. On the left side, Roberto Carlos, because he had a great World Cup. Not necessarily the final, but his World Cup was good. I would say that Petit had a good World Cup, and I would put him with Dunga, you know, and David. So the three of them, you know, and as defensive midfielders, those three guys.
Who's the other one? Petit, Dunga. Edgar Davids, oh yes, yes. Yeah, he had a good World Cup too.
He had a good World Cup. Zidane, I would put Laudrup, Michael Laudrup. It's
Michael Laudrup. Michael, yeah.
And striker, I will probably put Suker and Batistuta.
Oh, okay.
Nice. Yeah.
Nice. Interesting, nice. All right, Ram, yourself.
I think Benoit will be very happy with me because I also do have a few French players in my team. starting with Barthez as a goalkeeper, I think he was fantastic. You know, right back, I have Cafu, one of my favorite right backs for Brazil. I cannot leave out Maldini because Maldini is, you know, of course, the rock in Italy. So definitely for him in center back. Desailly, I thought Desailly was definitely also a solid rock for France. Left back, similar with Benoit, Roberto Carlos, because this guy, I was contemplating between him and Lizarazu, to be honest. But Roberto Carlos stood out because of his wicked left foot. So definitely that's why. Right hand side, right wing, I'll give David Beckham, because I think his crosses are phenomenal during that time. You know, he was, his free kicks, his crosses were amazing. Zidane definitely has to be in that team, because in central midfield, because he's just so difficult to win the ball against. Dunga as well, you know, in that team. On the left-hand side, I would have gone with Marc Overmars.
Okay. You know,
because Marc Overmars, for me, was one of those players that that I really, really, really had a lot of respect for, because he was quick. He had those skills and the directness of the football. So he had to be in that team. And for my two strikers, I would have gone with Christian Vieri and Davor Suker.
Okay. All right. For myself, I try and go a bit different from what you guys have chosen. So I'll go with Chilavert in goal. I had a choice of Barthez as well, of course, and Van der Sar in goal. But I think Chilavert in goal. Thuram at right back. Center back, I'm going with Blanc, Laurent Blanc, and Jaap Stam. Left back, I'm going with Robert Jani from Croatia. My midfield is going to be all-out attack. So I've got Michael Laudrup on one side. I got Boban and Zidane in center mid. Nobody's going to defend. On the left, I got Rivaldo. Think nobody's really spoken about him. I thought he had a really good World Cup.
Yeah.
Underrated World Cup. Ronaldo. Nobody's have got Ronaldo in his squad. So for me, Ronaldo and Vieri. A bit of, I've got to have an Italian player in there. So Vieri.
Vieri, I would be surprised if we didn't have one, bro.
I think you'd be surprised I didn't mention Baggio, but yeah, I'll give it to Vieri. Right. Okay. Thanks a lot, guys, for sharing your memories. I hope, you know, it's been as fun as it is for me sharing my memories with you guys and walking down memory lane, a bit of escapism for us at this age.
Very nostalgic, Russ. Well done.
Yeah, very nostalgic, right? Thinking back of how old we were at that point in time, what we were doing in our lives as well, because it's all connected with the tournament.
Yeah.
So thanks a lot, and do catch our previous episodes and the ones coming up. So thanks for taking your time once again to speak to us. It's me, Russ, signing out. Ciao.